Probability distributions come in different shapes and sizes, and so we tend to like to describe them with descriptors. You've likely heard of some of these descriptors in the past, such as the mean and variance of a random variable. However, there are quite a few ways to describe a random variable, and some of these tend to be less intuitive than others. For example, why is it that this distribution is not skewed? This one is skewed, but somehow this one is not skewed too? Or why is it that this distribution is considered more tail-heavy than this one? So what I've decided to do is put together a short 10-minute primer that goes through 12 core concepts underlying the ways we describe random variables. As always, I really value your time, so let's hop right into our topic. Let's start off by first discussing the ways we describe the central tendency of a probability distribution. Per standard notation, we'll refer to each possible outcome our random variable x can take on as x sub I, with each outcome having an associated probability. We'll look at discrete random variables in this video, as they tend to be a bit more intuitive to understand. Now, the first way we may think about describing the center of our distribution is based on its mode, which is simply the most probable value that x can take on, and I've highlighted that value here in blue. Now, with the mode of our distribution, we are really focusing our attention on a single value to describe our random variable, the outcome with the single largest associated probability. However, there are other ways we may want to think about defining our central tendency, particularly in this case, given that our distribution's mode is pretty to the left. One way to do so is the median, where we are looking for the value, x sub m, where there is a 50% chance that x could be both below and above it. Finally, there is the mean of x, but before we get to that, we should briefly discuss what a moment is in probability, as it is the basis for the mean and other statistics for a random variable. The idea of moments in probability likely comes from physics, where we are expressing a physical quantity that exists at some distance from a reference point. Moments help explain why, if you want to tighten a nut with a wrench, it is often easier to do so the further away from the nut you apply that force. The amount of force applied matters, but so too does the distance at which it is applied. Now, the kth raw moment for a random variable, mu sub k, which we also call the expected value of x raised to the k, is a weighted average of each possible outcome that x can take on, raised to the k, weighted according to its probability of occurrence. Now, one way to view our raw moment is as a weighted average, but an alternative way to view it, and the way that I prefer, is that we are computing the total moment of our distribution relative to an axis point of zero. As such, if we go back to the example of a wrench, each outcome x represents our moment arm or distance, and each probability is our physical quantity. Now, the most famous raw moment is its first one. It is the mean or expected value of x, where we weight each possible value of x according to its probability of occurrence. As you can see here, the mode, median, and mean of a random variable can all differ. This is particularly the case for an asymmetric distribution. However, for more symmetric distributions, it is possible for all three of these values to be the same. Up until this point, we've only discussed describing the central tendency of our random variables. However, given that a random variable describes the probability of a range of possible outcomes, we also likely want a measure to describe its dispersion too. This brings us back to the concept of moments. However, unlike raw moments, we are going to compute our moments around our random variable's mean. This is referred to as a central moment and helps us understand what is happening around the location or central tendency of our distribution. The most famous central moment is the second central moment, which is otherwise known as the variance of a random variable, which we denote as sigma squared. If moments are new to you, here again we are computing a weighted average based on our probabilities, but now according to the amount each outcome deviates from its mean squared. As each deviation is squared, our variance must be positive, and as the dispersion in our distribution increases, so too does our computed variance. Now, because we just squared each outcome, the units of our variance doesn't necessarily align with the units of our random variable x. We therefore sometimes prefer to describe the dispersion in a distribution by taking the square root of its variance, and we call this its standard deviation. And now that the units are consistent with x, we can compute something called the coefficient of variation, which is the ratio of the standard deviation to the mean. In other words, we are characterizing the dispersion in our distribution relative to how much its central location deviates from zero. Through some experience, this descriptor can be quite helpful in quickly understanding both the dispersion and location of a distribution through a single measure. Now, to further describe our random variables, and in particular the tails of our distribution, we typically rely on a third type of moment, standardized moments. Before delving, though, into standardized moments, we should probably first know what standardization means in the world of probability. Let's take one of our random variables x from earlier, but now transform it into a new variable z. We'll do this by, for each outcome, subtracting off our mean for x, and then dividing by its standard deviation. Let's see this in action by first expanding our x-axis from earlier. We can now subtract off our mean for x for each outcome, shifting our distribution to the left, and now we can divide by our standard deviation. It's a bit hard to see, though, our new distribution, so let's zoom in a bit. By taking off our mean, we have centered our distribution around zero, and by dividing by its standard deviation, we have altered its overall spread. Now let's do the same process, but with a different random variable, and notice that something similar happens. The distribution is now largely centered around zero, and we again have rescaled its spread. By standardizing our two random variables, we are in essence stripping away the fact that our two distributions are both centrally located around two different means and have exhibited two different amounts of spread according to their standard deviation. This allows us to better comment on differences between them, though, beyond simply their location and spread. Standardized moments are therefore moments just like we've seen earlier, but now for our standardized random variables, z. Now, the first important standardized moment is our third one, which is commonly referred to as skewness. Skewness aims to quantify the relative size of the tails for our distribution, and that is due to our exponent. Specifically, if we are raising each of our standardized values to the third power, those values of z much larger than 1 should contribute quite a bit towards our skewness calculation. Here, I've computed the moment being generated for each value of z according to our third standardized moment formula. Because our exponent is odd, standardized values to the left of 0 should lead to negative values, which I've highlighted in blue, while those to the right of 0 should be positive, which I've highlighted in green. Now, if we sum all of these third standardized moments for a symmetric distribution like this one, we arrive at 0. The best way to interpret this is that the relative size of our two tails are the same. Now let's plot our standardized and non-standardized distributions side by side to better appreciate how changes in our distribution for x affect our skewness coefficient. Notice that, if I have a distribution that looks tail-heavy to the right, we will end up with a positive skewness coefficient. And, conversely, if our distribution is skewed to the left, we should end up with a negative coefficient. So the sign of our skewness coefficient gives us a sense of whether our distribution is right-skewed or left-skewed. And its magnitude gives us a sense of the relative size difference between the two tails. Having said that, just because a distribution is asymmetric does not necessarily mean that its skewness cannot be zero. Here is one example I came up with for this video. Here, the right tail for the distribution is a bit longer but thinner than the left tail of the distribution. The end result is a skewness coefficient that is equal to zero. In my opinion, this highlights that asymmetry and skewness are oftentimes conflated concepts. While it is true that symmetric distributions will have a skewness of zero, skewness is really a measure of the relative size of our distribution tails, rather than symmetry itself. Now, while skewness speaks to the relative size of the tails of our distribution, kurtosis speaks to the combined size of them. Kurtosis is simply our fourth standardized moment, and so the relative contribution of our distribution tails again dominate this calculation. Because we are raising each standardized outcome to the fourth power, kurtosis must be positive for a random variable. And for a distribution that looks like the normal distribution, you will typically get a kurtosis score of 3. For this reason, you'll sometimes see the tailedness of a distribution reported as excess kurtosis, which is simply our kurtosis minus 3. In other words, how tail-heavy is our distribution relative to a normal distribution? And, of course, the more tail-heavy our distribution is, the higher our kurtosis. To make sure that kurtosis makes sense, let's go back to something I said at the start of this video. Let's print the mean and standard deviation of our underlying random variable and flatten it so it looks like a uniform distribution. At first glance, this distribution might look pretty tail-heavy, as values such as 0 and 100 now have a non-zero probability associated with them. However, note that our standard deviation has grown substantially too. Consequently, when we standardize our random variable, it becomes apparent that our standardized random variable is actually less tail-heavy, as all values outside the bounds of -2 and 2 have zero probability associated with them. This reflects in our kurtosis value, which is why it is really important to understand standardized moments and how they actually work. I hope that you found this video helpful and now have a good sense of the ways we describe our probability distributions. And for those who follow this channel, thanks as well for your patience. We recently welcomed our newest member to the family, and so the distribution around the time I've had in a given week to produce content has gone from something that looks like this to this. Things seem to be settling in though, so I'll be returning to the norm shortly. Thanks as always, like, share, or comment, and I'll see you soon.